From the book of Exodus. In those days, in their thirst for water, the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "Why did you ever make us leave Egypt? Was it just to have us die here of thirst with our children and our livestock?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? A little more, and they will stone me." The Lord answered Moses, "Go over there in front of the people, along with some of the elders of Israel, holding in your hand, as you go, the staff with which you struck the river. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock in Horeb. Strike the rock, and the water will flow from it for the people to drink." This Moses did in the presence of the elders of Israel. The place was called Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled there and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord in our midst or not?" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in hope of the glory of God. And hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For Christ, while we were still helpless, died at the appointed time for the ungodly. Indeed, only with difficulty does one die for a just person, though perhaps for a good person, one might even find courage to die. But God proves his love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Water. Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come back. The woman answered him and said to him, I do not have a husband. Jesus answered her, you are right in saying, I do not have a husband. You have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true. The woman said to him, sir, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worship on this mountain. But you people say that the place to worship is in Jerusalem. Jesus said to her, believe you, woman, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You people worship what you do not understand. We worship what we understand because salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. Indeed, the Father seeks such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. The Lord said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming, the one called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us everything. Jesus said to her, I am he, the one who is speaking to you. At that moment, his disciples returned, were amazed that he was talking to a woman. But still went on and asked, what are you looking for, or why are you talking to her? The Lord left her water jar, went into town, and said to the people, come, see a man who told me everything I have done. Could he possibly be the Christ? They went out from the town and came to him. Meanwhile, the disciples urged him, Rabbi, eat. He said to them, I have food to eat which you do not know. So the disciples said to one another, if someone had brought him something to eat, Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of the one who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say, in 4 months the harvest will be here? I tell you, look up and see the fields ripe for the harvest. The reaper is already receiving payment and gathering crops for eternal life. So the sower and reaper can rejoice together. For here is the saying is verified that one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap what you have not sown and worked for. Others have done the work, and you are sharing the fruit of their work. Many Samaritans in that town began to believe in him because of the word the woman had testified. He told me everything I have done. When the Samaritans came to him, they invited him to stay with them. He stayed there for 2 days. Many more began to believe in him because of his word. And they said to the woman, we no longer believe because of your word. We have heard for ourselves.
Then it's Palm Sunday. At least the gospel on Easter is blessedly short, because if it was much longer, it would collapse. This could have been longer. He could have done the whole thing in Irish. I dare you. Anyway, God certainly has a sense of humor this morning. And it took a while to dawn. Well, I mean, I know that God has a sense of humor, but it just took a while to dawn on me today. His responsorial psalm this morning is Psalm 95. Psalm 95 is literally something I pray every morning. It's part of the liturgy of the hours that everyone that's ordained to a religious life is obligated to pray every day. The first thing you do when you start your day is you pray the invitatory psalm. And it's the psalm that is just supposed to kick off your entire morning. And there's like three options for it, but Psalm 95 is the easiest, it's the one I do the most, and so, you know, it's where I'm at. We lost an hour of sleep last night, and it's been a very crazy week. So me in the chapel of my rectory this morning, come let us sing to the Lord and shout with joy to God who sings as coming forth and free. And then I get here, you're all peppy and excited to sing Psalm 95. The Catholic guilt is just welling up within me. It's supposed to be a spring of life-giving water welling up on us today, and instead it's Catholic guilt. There's reasons they make us pray that psalm every day. And there's actually another stanza of it that doesn't get sung as part of the responsorial psalm, but there's a reason that we're supposed to pray it every day. And it's because it's a very important message. If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts. I need to be reminded of that. I think we all need to be reminded of that so often and so consistently, because we're really good at hardening our hearts. We're really good at hearing the voice of God and then not wanting to listen to it. And the thing is the gospel makes it very clear in this very long passage, hearing that voice is a very important thing for us to do. This whole scenario in the gospel today is Jesus is being very deliberate here, because he doesn't have to be in this town at all. To get from where he was to Jerusalem, which is where he is going, He does not have to go through Samaria. He does not have to go through the town of Sychar. He doesn't have to go anywhere near these people. And most Jews wouldn't have. There was another road that he could have taken that would not have extended his journey that much. But he chose to go through the Samaritan villages. He wants to have encounters with these people. And God, in his wisdom and God in his humor, is going to put people in positions where they can have this encounter with Jesus, like this unnamed Samaritan woman, who should not have been at the well when she was in fact at the well. Like, it makes sense for Jesus to be there. He's on a journey. It's hot. He's tired. He needs a break. He's going to stop and sit next to a place where he can get water. But why is she there? Well, she's drawing water from her household. Yeah, but why at noon? Why in the heat of the day? Why were the days half spent and you've already needed it? Why then are you going to drag your big stone water jar to the well to fill it up to take it back? And the Samaritan woman is there because I think she just wants to be left alone. We heard that there's a little bit of backstory in her life. She sounds like she's carrying some baggage, right? She's a complicated woman. And she's probably tired of having to deal with people. The people that gossip about her. The people that talk about her behind her back. The people that talk about her right in front of her face. She just doesn't want to have to deal with any of that. So she's going to wait until noon to go to the well, even though it makes things way more inconvenient for her. And then she goes to the well and she encounters this random Jewish man who's just sitting there. It seems like poor timing on her part, but it's perfect timing on God's. And so they start to have a conversation. And it's not a really pleasant conversation. She's a little bit antagonistic. Jesus is kind of pushing her buttons a little bit. Hey, give me a drink. You don't even have a bucket. What kind of idiot comes to a well doesn't bring a bucket? So they're arguing back and forth. And then it turns out this isn't a conversation about water. This conversation is going to get a little bit deeper. Then we start talking about morals and ethics. And that gets kind of deep for a while. And then we start talking about proper worship. But she's at least going to listen to what Jesus has to say. And Jesus is coming up with all of these answers. Jesus is coming up with all of this truth. And he's exposing some things about her life that she really needs to confront. That she really needs to deal with. He's not passing judgment on her. He's not being a gossiper like all of these other folks in this town. He's just bringing some stuff to the surface. So that, hey, you know, you've got to address this. You've got to fix this. You can do better. You're made for better. Finally, she says, look, I know that there's a Messiah coming, the one called the Christ. And when he gets here, he's going to explain all of this, and I'll be okay. And Jesus says, I'm me. The one speaking to you. It's about as obvious as he ever makes it in the course of the Gospels that he is in fact the Savior of mankind. The rest of the people won't get it until the cross. Some of them don't even get it then. But he says to her point blank, I am he, the one speaking to you. You want a solution to this? You want this to get fixed? Then I hope you've been paying attention to what it is I've been saying. She has been. Because it changes everything. She just leaves that stone water jar. All of a sudden, that chore that was very important, that still is very important, doesn't seem so vital anymore. And she goes running back into the town to encounter these people that we imagined heretofore were kind of rude to her. But rather than dealing with them with their gossip and being angry, she says, you have to come with me. Come listen to the man that I've been listening to. Because he knows stuff and things. And this is a fascinating conversation that we've been having. And I think he might be the Christ. And the people from this town go, and this whole town has changed. Because they start to listen to Jesus. And they start to understand truth. And they start to understand what it is they're called for, and called to, and capable of. And in 2 days, Jesus changes the trajectory of this entire town. And they're able to say this bold proclamation of faith. We no longer believe because of your word, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world. What a beautiful profession of faith. But it only comes because they were able and willing to listen. So every morning the church makes us think about whether or not we have hardened our hearts and whether or not we are willing to hear his voice. And that's a good thing to ponder during our Lenten journey. Are we hardening our hearts towards it? Are we listening for his voice? We start Lent often with pious aspirations. We're going to do all of these things. And the wheels will start to come off because they always do. And then we think, we have to start doing more. I have to save Lent. I have to make Lent better or holier, whatever it is. What if you were never meant to be in charge of it? What if it's God's Lent? What if he's the one that's trying to do things to you? We try to do things to him. That's never worked. We just need to listen. We need to be in a position of receptivity. And now that we're more or less halfway through, it's a good time to just kind of stop and see where we're at. Are we listening? Have we let our hearts get hard? And if they have, this is a perfect opportunity to ask Jesus to heal them. And if we're not listening as well as we should, this is a perfect time to ask for that particular grace, to be able to hear his word so that it can change us and so that we can share it with others. He wants to use us this Lent the same way he used the Samaritan, to build up his kingdom on earth so that one day we can be happy with him in the kingdom of heaven. If today you hear his voice, harden not your heart. I believe in one God,
Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only God, Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven.
Offered.
Let us praise the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, hear and answer these prayers we make in faith, that they be in accord with your holy will. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Second question, please, from my mercy of heaven.
Oh,
holy, O Lord, and from the world's beginning are ceaselessly at work, so that the human race may become holy, just as you yourself are holy. Look, we pray, upon your people's offerings, and pour out on them the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, in whom we too are your sons and daughters. Indeed, though we once were lost and could not approach you, you loved us with the greatest love. For your Son, who alone is just, handed himself over to death, and did not disdain to be nailed for our sake to the wood of the cross. But before his arms were outstretched between heaven and earth, to become the lasting sign of your covenant, he desired to celebrate the Passover with his disciples. As he ate with them, he took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, knowing that he was about to reconcile all things in himself through his blood to be shed on the cross, he took the chalice, filled with the fruit of the vine, and once more giving you thanks, handed the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. This sacrificial victim who reconciles to you the human race. Look kindly, most compassionate Father, on those who unite to yourself by the sacrifice of your Son, and grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, as they partake of this one bread and one chalice, they may be gathered into one body in Christ, who heals every division. Be pleased to keep us always in communion of mind and heart, together with Francis our Pope and David our Bishop. Help us to work together for the coming of your kingdom, until the hour when we stand before you, saints among the saints in the halls of heaven, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles and all the saints, and with our deceased brothers and sisters, whom we humbly commend to your mercy. Then, freed at last from the wound of corruption, and made fully into a new creation, we shall sing to you with gladness the thanksgiving of Christ, who lives for all eternity. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Peace I leave you, my peace I give you.
Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And now let us offer another sacrifice, peace.
An act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Thank you.
things yet hidden in heaven and are nourished while still on earth with the bread that comes from on high. We humbly entreat you, O Lord, that what is being brought about in us in mystery may come to true completion. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Solemn Vespers will be celebrated every Sunday during Lent at 6 p.m. in Penn Hill, so join us for that. We'll offer special Mass every Tuesday during Lent at 7 p.m. here in Monroe with the visiting priest. And we have confessions beginning at 6 p.m. those evenings. Fish Fry continues to be a great success. Continue to come out and support it. We're doing really well. Thank you for your help. Stations are prayed every Friday at 4 p.m. in both churches and 7 p.m. in Monroe. And next Sunday, the 19th, at 2 p.m., there will be a penance service for the parish in Monroe.
And if you're looking for something to do this afternoon, I'm taking a nap, but if you're looking for something to do this afternoon, the Divine Mercy Academy varsity boys basketball team is playing for the Diocesan Championship at 4 p.m. at North Catholic, which is too far. Well, I'd be back for evening prayer, but anyway, either go cheer on the Sabres or say a rosary for the Sabres or something like that. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit. Hold on for the blessing.
Direct, O Lord, we pray, the hearts of your faithful, and in your kindness grant your servants this grace, that abiding in the love of you and their neighbor, they may fulfill the whole of your commands. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And I'll proclaim the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.